Hello everybody and welcome to this quick run through on APID identification. So quickly, we're going to run through why identify, not only whether it's an APID, but also what APID species. Looking at a few identification features, not everything. The example species, so there are about 500 APID species out there, so we're only going to look at a few, and probably a few of the most likely ones we're going to find on horticultural crops, some horticultural crops, and a few references that are available. So why identify? If you have a pest problem, it's nice to know whether we actually require an apicide or not. In biological control, it might be nice to know which parasitic wasps will work against it, or predators might work against it. So by knowing that, we can target the control rather better in biological. If you're using chemicals, it's nice to know whether the pest we've got here is going to be resistant to what we're intending to use. And it may be quite useful to know what the host range of the aphid species we've got is. So by identification, we get a better idea of what we're trying to do. Looking more generally at the aphid, or aphids, looking over the crop, we'll probably see some distortion of leaf. We might see some cast skins on the leaves beneath where they're actually actively working. And we also see some, potentially, if it's a high infestation, honeydew. And if it's been there for a while, sooty mould growing on the honeydew. This is the sugar that's secreted by a range of sucking insects. So looking at how we identify, how do we know it's an aphid, or whether we are looking at whatever species we might be thinking it is. We'd be looking at the general shape of the insect. We have an image, a line diagram here of peach potato aphid, but it's from above. A sideways view, we'd probably find it was a stylet where it would be attached to the plant. We'd also be looking out for winged and non-winged forms. So the wing they call alate forms or apterous forms, non-winged. The aphids form their wings very often in high density populations. And that's the winged form which will probably quite easily carry the aphid from one plant to another. We're then looking at the tail, the quarter, at the back end of the aphid, at the end of the abdomen. Then most aphid species will have these structures on the back called siphunculi or cornicles. They look rather like exhaust pipes, but they're not. They tend to secrete things like pheromones and can fight off in some instances any parasites that might be attacking them. We're then looking at the head shape, particularly this area between the antennae. The length, shape, colour of the antennae and of the siphunculi. The general coloration of the insect, the size of the insect, some of them are small aphid, some of them are large, and as I said before, the general shape. And then it's nice to know what plant species it's been found on. Some of those aphid species are what they call polyphagous, they're feeding on many plant species, or they may be just confined to one single plant type, or usually plant family. Moving on to an example species, peach potato aphid, very common aphid species, Mysis persici. This is the diagram we saw before. As I said, the colour can be variable depending, I think, some instance, what it's been feeding on. And also, I think there's some subspecies in here. There are winged forms and non-winged forms. This is just the non-winged form. We've got an example here. And it's up to 1.8 millimetres long, mature aphid. And then we're looking at the general insect shape. Short triangular quarter. The marker is showing that quarter. The siphunculi. This diagram is showing a slight bulbous end on them. I can't see that on the actual aphid. And I can't actually see on this image here, this general head detail that's shown on this line diagram here. But with a hand lens, live species, you can actually turn around and quickly check that matches. Or you get your eye in on what the aphid looks like. So that one's polyphagous. Most of these will be on. I mean, showing a few examples here, will be growing on quite a range of particularly glasshouse and ornamentals. Glasshouse potato aphid, range of glasshouse crops, ornamentals, tomatoes, lettuce. This one in particular has a very obvious identification feature in this darkened area at the base of the siphunculi. Here, shown on this image, shown in real life there. It's a fairly big aphid species, up to 3 millimeters long. And at low density will cause yellow patches and distortion on the plant because of toxic saliva. You can see a little bit more of the head detail on this one here. And the image beneath, we can see a winged form and non-winged form. And we can see some of the less mature forms of the aphid around here. If you're looking at them, be aware that sometimes we have, may have more than one species in a colony. We will have invariably in any colony the juveniles, because these will be giving life to, giving birth to live young. So we end up some juveniles, some matures, and in a high density situation, we'll see some aphids with wings on them. Then we have a potato aphid, Macrocyphum euphorbi, again, a large aphid species. This one, antennae are longer than the body. I can't on this image see the antennae very well. It seems to be about the length of the body there. The tail is about half the length of the quarter. The tail is half the length of the siphunculi, which are these long and slender processes at the back of the abdomen of the aphid. Colour green to pinkish and red body. Melon cotton aphid, another example. This is a very matte coloured, not a shiny species, variable in colour, yellow to dark green. Siphunculi are black. Many host plants and common on glasses ornamentals. The images here on the left come from the Belchim Guide to Aphid, very much, I think, maximising their aphid guide to a range of arable crops, but they do mention cucurbits and ornamentals. And of course, with all of these aphids, we are concerned about aphid transmitting viruses. Another example of an aphid, Aphis fabi, black bean aphid. This one, we end up with these white wax patches, or pale patches, showing up on the images, and the line diagrams showing fairly short, short antennae, pale yellow with a black tip, black siphunculi, fairly black body colour, white wax markings. Very common on beans and some ornamentals. This one overwinters on the spindle bush. So a number of these aphid species have fairly complicated life cycles with alternative hosts. In the autumn, in certainly out of the greenhouse, they will form males and females who will lay eggs on alternative host. They will overwinter as eggs. In the spring, they will hatch. They'll move back to the summer hosts. So keep an eye on what's going on outside as well. Then we have a mottled arum aphid, Olecorthum circumflexum. Common on greenhouse ornamentals, quite a range of them, and pepper, quite a wide host range. The markings on the adult are quite distinct, can be a little bit variable, but the juveniles don't show those markings, but a similar colour to the body. A few other examples I've shown in here is a woolly aphid, woody plant species, the wool, wax in the wool protecting the aphid, which is underneath it. And then a root aphid. This example is a lettuce root aphid. This one, alternative host, is poplar, where it overwinters, and it root feeds on lettuce. And very much reduced if visible siphunculi, if you look at the damaged roots. One other example I put in here is mummified aphids. So these aphids have been parasitized by a parasitic wasp, as in biological control. And you will see that they've swollen up, still attached to the leaf, to the stylet. And we have an emergence hole cut through by the emerging parasitic larvae. It's emerged and will then hopefully complete your life cycle and continue the work. We've still got some live aphid in the colony, but we have some Aphidolites larvae coming in here who are also feeding on the colony. But look out for these mummified aphid. They're still aphid, but they've been actually parasitized by biological control. So some reference materials to look at. You've got the Bayer Expert Guide to Aphids. It's available online. Quite a range of aphid species in there. Belcher have produced a guide to identification of aphids and their natural enemies. It's quite a good book, quite worth looking at. Again, available online. AHDB, Pop Walker's Guides. There's two examples there. They've both got a few aphid species within them. And if you want a summary with quite a few aphid species, not everything, but quite a range of them, the Knowing and Raising, Recognising Price publication, available from good horticultural suppliers, lists quite a few aphid species and how to recognise them. Right, coming to the end of what I've got to say, but I've quickly looked at why we need to identify some identification features, a few examples, and a few reference materials. Thank you for watching. Thank you.